Hi everyone, today we'll talk about code obfuscation. Data can be pushed into the stack instead of being initialized in the data section, in order to hide as much information as possible. Storing data in the hexadecimal format helps in making data more difficult to read and be spotted. Assembly opcodes and operands can also be stored into the stack, from where they can be retrieved and executed by the program, which makes reverse engineering more difficult. Modern operating systems might disable execution of code stored into the stack, which then can only be used to store data, as it should be. Let's have a look at strings. Strings can actually say a lot about your program, so you want to hide them. Let's have a look at this program over here. Okay, all it does is printing this string over here. Okay, so let's build it. Okay, let's run it. Okay, it's printing the string. Now let's grab our hexadecimal viewer. Okay. Oh, here it is. That's my string, right? Here it is. Now, if we open this one again, you see that we actually declare the string in the data section. Therefore, I can use object dump to decompile this application and look into the data section. So this option is saying please use the Intel assembly. This one is saying please look into the data section and give me everything. And then this one is minus D is disassemble this file over here. Let's see what happens. Oh, sorry. Yep. Here it is. That's my string in the data section. Now, you don't want that because you want to hide your strings. Let's have a look at this other program instead. So in here, we are using the stack and we are storing the string using the hexadecimal format, right? That's the X number, which is translated into ASCII code, which is basically string, right? Okay. So, as you can see here, I'm not using the data section and you can't see any string. Let's see what happens when I run this application. So, let's build it first. And let's run it. Oh, that's my string. Right? I'm missing the new line char, but that's okay. I mean, that's my string. So if I open my hexadecimal viewer, I can get something, but as you can see, it's a little bit confusing. And if I open my object dump and I say I ask him to disassemble the second application, we get nothing. Why? Well, we didn't declare any data section, right? Let's have a look at this one again. Yep. So as you can see, there is no data section. So when I'm asking object dump to disassemble the data section, it obviously can't find anything, right? And that's it's a very strong technique that you can use to hide your strings and Also, you can actually hide opcodes, which means actually assembly code, into the stack by using the same technique, right? By using the actual opcode, right? And you can store into the stack and then you can execute it from the stack. However, just remember that modern system will try to stop it. We'll try to stop that because it's dangerous, obviously, right? Code encryption with XOR. Widely used as very simple to implement. Code can be encrypted and decrypted using the same algorithm. So that's the code you wanna encrypt, that's the key, and that's the result. And that's the same even when you wanna decrypt. So you will put your code in here and so far, right? Now you get one when the code and the key are different, otherwise you get zero. Now, this algorithm is weak if used by itself, but is stronger if mixed with other technologies. Also, XOR is strong if the keys are randomly generated and they are as long as the code that has to be encrypted. Code encryption with other algorithms. Now, code can be encrypted using any of the available algorithms, and none of them will be covered here due to the complexity involved in this topic. However, remember that the entry function of any encrypted program must be able to understand the code that is to be executed, which means that any encrypted program before executing has to be able to decrypt the code, right? Encrypting and decrypting with loops. Encryption and decryption algorithms can be executed in loop cycles controlled by conditional jumps. These cycles often point at the memory location or label where the code that has to be encrypted or decrypted is located. Let's have a look at this example. So your code is going to be located at this address over here. You copy this address into this register. And then you're using ESX as an index for this loop, right? Now you copy the content of this memory into AL, and then by using simple math, you're going to encrypt the content of the memory, right? So this is going to be your encryption key. So when you're going to decrypt the code, you're gonna be using this key again. Now you're copying AL into ESI, you move to the next chunk, and then you decrease the index, and so on. Storing code and data on the heap. In both Linux and Windows, space on the heap is created by using the malloc function. With malloc, the dynamic space where to store the code is created on the heap, while the pointer to the space may be created on the stack. And that's the program that we're going to use to write and encrypt some numbers on the heap. Now, to manage the space on the heap, we're going to use the BRK system call, right? When we pass 0 to BRK, the system call is going to return the location of the beginning of the heap. And then we call BRK again and we specify the size that we need on the heap, right? Then we can write something on the heap. At the end of the heap, right? And then With this loop over here, we are going to encrypt the content of the heap using the XOR algorithm with this key. Okay, so we can build the program. Make sure you are also including the debugging symbols. Okay, we start our debugging session. Okay, so as we said before, we need to call brk twice. So if I put, for example, a breakpoint here, I'm not gonna see any heap over here, right? Okay, so I can run the program. And now I need to grab the process ID of my application, which is this. Okay, so now using this line over here and replacing my process ID, which is this one, 19437, that's correct. I'm not seeing anything as expected. And then I go back to my debugging session. And then I do next, next, next. And then I go back to here. And that's my heap as expected. And I also get in writing, write, read, and execution permission, right? I can exec, write, and read. Okay, so that's my session. So next, 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 next. Right before my encryption section starts, I'm gonna explore the content of the registry that contains the string or the number that I'm going to encode. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, right? Okay. So, as you can see, it's still wherever I typed over here, right? So it has not been encrypted. And then I do next, next, next. Okay, here I can type my string again and voila, it's been encrypted. Control flow flattening. This technique adds a set of conditional jumps where they will not be needed, so that even simple programs become difficult to read. Garbage code insertion. This technique adds lines of code that do absolutely nothing, so that even simple programs become difficult to read. Metamorphism. This technique replaces simple sequences of instructions with similar ones that do the same thing, but they are much more difficult to read. Here, this line of code and this group over here achieve exactly the same thing, but the one on the left is much easier than having to read six lines of code. This technique makes malwares much more difficult to detect, as the signatures that are stored into the antivirus database will not match. Remember, these malwares will have different looking code achieving exactly the same result. Dynamic library loading. Static analysis can only reveal API functions that are present in the import table, the one that you can populate with your imports. But many more can be loaded from the code by using system calls. API function's name can then be encrypted by using one of the techniques that we covered during this course and then loaded when needed, in order to prevent tools such as strings from revealing their presence. Packers, those are tools that compress executable files, which makes the code more difficult to read and reverse engineer. Self-extracting archives are compressed packages that contain the relevant decompression code. Packers might modify the ELF and PE sections, making compressed files unreadable to programs such as readelf and readPE. Protectors. These software packages compress and encrypt files, often using several layers of encryption and compression. MIME, the Internet SMTP protocol, was designed to exchange text-only messages, but soon binary files were needed. Therefore, in 1996, the MIME standard was created. This protocol allows users to attach binary files to their emails by converting binary into 7-bit ASCII text using Base64 encoding. Modern servers do support 8-bit ASCII text via the 8-bit MIME extension. So, a file that looks like just plain text might actually be binary encapsulating a malware. Be careful. More practical examples. When possible, use relative or indirect addressing, like the following. Use GNC instead of the other jumping instructions, as GNC jump when the carry flag register is not set, which makes the code much more confusing. In fact, CF will be set, for example, if the result of an addition is bigger than the capacity of the register, or when a big number is subtracted from a smaller one. GNC jumps make the code more difficult to read. So, use binary instructions in your assembly file. Read the assembler manual to find out how to write binary code in your assembly file. Conclusion. Always assume that any working program can be reverse engineered. While it is easy to confuse an engineer, it is much harder to stop reverse engineering tools. And I hope you've enjoyed my class. Thank you very much.